This is quite possibly the most difficult demonstration and the most difficult, or at least one of the most difficult subject matters to try to draw. The reason for this, and I'll get into it in greater detail later, is that cars are made up of extremely specific curves. And the more you deviate from these very clear designed curves in all three dimensions of space, the more you deviate from them, the more quickly you're going to realize that this doesn't look like a car that anyone would ever drive. And so in Drawabox, we use construction at every step of the way to really establish and build up our understanding of 3D space. We use it as an exercise as we're drawing things. And when it comes to cars, that starts to break down somewhat. It's not that cars aren't built up just like everything else from a series of simple forms. And you certainly can rely on some of those concepts to varying degrees. But when you get into a car like this, it gets very tricky very fast. And you suddenly start realizing that it makes a lot more sense to start relying on what you've developed of your understanding of 3D space and start pushing forward from there, combining observation and construction in ways that we've only slowly started to hint at. So in a lot of ways, cars are like the final boss of Drawbox. And if you can pull off a beautiful sports car or a muscle car or whatever, then you have learned a great deal. I still have students who, completing lesson 7, struggle immensely with cars, and there is nothing to be ashamed of there. There's a lot of practice that is really necessary to be able to even begin to grasp this stuff. So I want you to try cars. I absolutely do, but I don't want you to feel any expectation that just because you can nail all the other constructions, that this is going to be anything remotely easy for you. So let's get started. And just to warn you, this is probably going to be a long video. I hope it's not. I have to go to a work party soon. But this file is about 40 layers, and this demo took me over an hour and a half to draw. Hopefully, we can get through it much faster than that, but we'll see. So, this is Eleanor. You may recognize her from Gone in 60 Seconds, the Nicolas Cage movie from probably the early 2000s or the late 90s. It's one of my favorite movies growing up, and I really fell in love with this car. It's a 67 Ford Mustang, a Shelby Mustang Fastback. And it's beautiful. If anyone wants to buy me one, I would happily oblige, although I don't think I would know how to drive it. Anyway, getting into this, you can see that I've picked up a lot of different photos from different angles of the same car, and they do generally help a lot in understanding all the complexities, all the proportions, and everything. Still, it is so much better to be able to go up to an actual car and look at it and do this from observation from life, but we don't generally have these cars laying around. So, you do what you can. So using these photo references, which I all got from the same website, the thing with cars is that you'll often have many variations of the same car, and they may have different features. For example, there's a different kind of Shelby Mustang that is not a fastback, and fastback is referring to how the curve just continues all the way down to the back. And that's an important feature to keep in mind. So if you're using different kinds of reference, you can work from that. But you're going to hit a point where it becomes very difficult to kind of consolidate the differences between them into the vehicle that you're creating. So just keep that in mind. I was really lucky here to be able to get all these images off of one website, and I'll include a link in the whole lesson page to where I got this reference from. I think they were doing some project where they were either photographing the replica or, moving it or I don't know, something. But anyway. So moving this out of the way, we are going to start out by first studying the car itself. This is a pretty good shot. I wouldn't necessarily do it from a single angle, but I was kind of running out of time. I didn't want this demo to take quite so long. So we're going to try and study the proportions from both from all three dimensions of this car, and we're not going to get it spot on. We're just not. Identifying that in the means that we have, meaning not being overly technical about finding the vanishing points and everything, actually pinning things down on a car with this many curves and turns is going to be very difficult. But we can ballpark it, and we can kind of start to get there. So the first thing that I look at is the wheels and the space between the wheels. So I look at where one wheel ends. I actually got this a little bit off, but whatever. All the way down to the where the other wheel ends. And I've drawn a rectangle on it, kind of estimating the convergence towards a vanishing point off in this direction. So, you know, there's a vanishing point off here, and these lines should be parallel, so they're converging towards it. And so I've created a plane that encompasses both. Now I want to split up this plane and find out just how many wheels long it is. The wheel is a good unit of measurement because it's being a circle. It also means that any plane that encompasses it perfectly is going to be a square. And so that can give us a unit to work with for the construction of this entire car. So I've split this off to roughly encompass this wheel. I was a little bit off, but no big deal. And using basic perspective, if you're at this point, you should have already grasped or you know learned this from lesson 6. But to put it simply, if you want to find the center of a plane in perspective or not, you can draw the diagonals across on each from either corner, and this intersection point will be the center. You can also then take that, which you'll see in the next step, and drawing a line through the middle, you can mirror, or not mirror, but transfer this distance over. And you can see that I took a line and I drew it from this corner through the center off the far end of the plane, which we figured out because we drew this center line going through the middle of the plane. So we pass it through here, and it replicate and it kind of hits the top line. And in doing so, you've now got this is one length, and this is the same length repeated. So you'll see us applying that here. Now, we figured out that there are about 3 wheel lengths in between the two wheels. If you extend it, you've got 7. Now, the numbering here, I went back to 0. I actually ended up screwing that up a little bit later on, where I thought it was only 6 lengths. It is 7. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's 7 wheel lengths. From roughly one end to the other, it is hard to pin down where the end of this is, and I've also gone a little bit beyond here. I'm really just ballparking it because I'm not going to get into all the complexities of getting precise measurements. That's never been what Drawabox is about. Now, I'm applying the same principles. I notice that I'm implying all my vanishing points. I don't have any vanishing points in the frame at all. And so when it comes to there's some vanishing point over here. There's a vanishing point that's almost directly above, but there's probably a slight angle. Later on, I'm probably going to treat it more like being just two-point perspective. So I've got my convergences down. That's what Drawabox has been teaching you this whole time when you're getting used to boxes and pinning down these convergences and being able to estimate if you add a line here, how is it going to converge towards the same vanishing point? You should have all of that already down, so I'm not going to get into it. So here we have, I've applied the same principle of kind of transferring distances into the height. So I've extended the lines up, and I've crossed beyond. So if I imagine that this was a plane, I've cut up beyond this center point on the top, and found where it hit this side of the vertical line to find the same distance between here and here. And I'm starting to build myself a nice little grid. Unfortunately, this distance here is a little bit too much for me to just kind of say close enough. So I am going to say that that's roughly 2 1/4 boxes tall, or not boxes, but units. And moving on to the next step. I've tried to find my other vanishing point to the best of my abilities. I've looked at a lot of these parallel lines. I should have mentioned ahead of time, when you're doing these drawings, you can use whatever tools you want. I'd like you to use a ballpoint pen. Still much better than pencil, but fine liners might make this a little bit more difficult than it really needs to be. Use a ballpoint pen, use a ruler, use ellipse guides, use a French curve. French curves are basically just sets of pieces of plastic that are cut into all kinds of little curves that you can use. Like, say you want to get a curve that's like this, you'll only use this section of it. You can look all that stuff up, but basically French curves, ellipse guides, get whatever you need. This exercise, this challenge really, is not about how good you are at freehanding your lines. It is about learning how to construct something in such a way that you're able to capture what it, like, this, such a specific thing. Yes, we're roughing out some of these distances or whatever, but the nature of the curves, you can push and pull proportion a little bit, but you really have to nail the curves, nail those lines, make it solid. And so we are not testing you at all on your ability to freehand anything. Use the tools that you need to achieve this. I still do want you to do it traditionally. As I said, ideally, you know, with ballpoint pen. That's just the cheap, you know, the Bic pens or whatever. Most pens you have are probably ballpoint, so they'll be fine. Anyway, where was it? What was I saying? So I did try and find the vanishing points going off into this direction. I looked at where I had straight lines that I could find. And I would kind of extrapolate them off into the distance to find roughly what that convergence is like. And then using that, I could place an ellipse. This is where some of the methodology that we talked about when talking about cylinders, which you should be very comfortable with right now, having gone through the cylinder challenge, the box challenge, and all of that, you should be comfortable with the idea of what it takes to draw a perfect, or an ellipse that represents a perfect circle in 3D space. So if you don't understand what I'm talking about there, stop right now, check out the 250 cylinder video and the lesson and all of that. Go through it, take your time, you're getting ahead of yourself. So as we went over there, I've drawn this ellipse such that it falls between these two edges. It touches these two edges. I'll get a brighter red. It falls between these two edges, it touches this edge, and the points at which it contacts the top and bottom, if you draw a line through it, it should converge roughly towards the same vanishing point as these lines, your verticals. So that's the criteria for establishing that that is basically a representing a circle given the vanishing points and the alignment that we have. So having done that, I know that this is now also a square. We're kind of given this for free because we can trust that this wheel is a square, or is a, can be encompassed in a square because it's a perfect circle. And so here we are extending off, finding the center, because we want to do exactly what we did here. We just want to create our grid by carrying over these measurements. And now this got a little bit weird because of the fact that I'm working from a photograph that has all kinds of distortion on it from perspective and all these different little curves. I don't actually know where this vehicle comes to a stop. Like, it's probably around here. And so it seems to me like it's about 4, maybe a little bit more wheel widths, but I'm not 100% sure. I think I'll go with 4 just to simplify this. as I said before, you can push and pull the overall proportions of this car to within a certain limit before it starts to fall apart. So these kinds of rough measurements are not going to be a huge problem. So right now, we've got something that is roughly, where did I put it? 2 2/4 units tall, 7 units long, and 4 units wide. Knowing that, we can set all this aside and we can start our drawing. This has been the analysis phase. When you do it, if at all possible, try and work from images that capture both, like just the side and just the front. So if I were to look here, a better option here would have been this image where I've got a nice shot of the side. I should be able to pinpoint more precisely what the proportional breakdown is. I don't know if it has a great shot of the front. Maybe this one would be better. And so you're going to be, the link between the two is the fact that they have the same height. So what you would do here is you would determine how tall from this one. You have your square, and you determine how many square units tall this thing is, which we came to about 2 1/4. Then you take that, knowing that this vehicle here is 2 1/4 tall, and you would apply that. You'd find the actual square using that measurement, and then bring it across. Hopefully we're not that far off. I'm not super confident, but you know, it turned out okay in the end. Now, despite the fact that I'm not generally one to teach really heavy perspective concepts, and frankly, I'm not the one to learn them from because I don't use them, I wing it, but or at least what I'm about to explain to you, there is a lot to be learned from them. And so because it comes into play a little bit here, I'm going to discuss with you how we figure out when we're using two-point perspective for an object. How do we figure out how far apart to put these vanishing points? Like, let's say we're drawing in our pages or canvas is limited to this space. How do we know that these vanishing points are not too far apart? And what happens when you have vanishing points that are too close together is that your field of view gets very, very large. And when they're very far apart, your field of view gets very, very small. And a natural field of view is about 60 degrees. I'll explain what that means in a second. Well, actually, I'll explain it now. When you're looking at something, this is you, happy little person, you can only see a certain amount of what's in front of you. Naturally, that's going to be about 60 degrees. If we try and cram more than that into this space when we're drawing it, because we're essentially drawing what the person sees here, what is being projected onto their canvas or piece of paper. When we cram too much of it into there, we are giving them a much wider field of view, as though they could see all the way out to here, for example, and we're cramming it into this space. So that's going to start looking weird. And you get the opposite if you use a field of view that's too limited. You're going to take what would occupy a smaller space in the frame, and you're expanding it all the way. So here's a simple way to determine, if you're actually plotting out all your perspective, whether or not your vanishing points are too far apart. And you do that by first, well, you create your horizon line. This is actually backwards. Where your vanishing, your horizontal vanishing points, because we're talking about two-point perspective, where they're going to sit. Then you determine what is called a station point. Now, a station point is where, if you have from this point a line pointing to each vanishing point, the angle between these two lines needs to be 90 degrees. It's a right angle. So it's a very specific point respective to two vanishing points. And remember that these two vanishing points essentially represent lines that are perpendicular to each other. So lines that go off in this towards this vanishing point are going to be perpendicular in 3D space to the ones that go off towards this one. Once you've got your station point, What you do is you draw a line parallel to the horizon along here. You calculate a 45 degree angle and a 45 degree angle here. And using that, you draw a line back to the vanishing point, back to the horizon line. So many terms. This is why I hate dealing with perspective. And then your vanishing point is where they intersect. So here and here. And of course, I estimated that 45 degree angle because I'm not going to measure it out right now. So in essence, you also have a 45 degree angle here because of how geometry works. And this, between here, would encompass a 90 degree field of view, because that's what this represents. 90 degrees. This is obviously way too wide for us, because we want to deal with a 60 degree field of view. So what we do then is we want 60, we have 90, we take two-thirds. We take two-thirds of that. I don't know, somewhere like this. It's going to be two-thirds between here. And this is where we can put our picture plane, meaning the frame that we're drawing inside of. We can put our drawing in here, and we're going to be able to cover a 60-degree field of view. Now, we're not going to be applying this specific technique to this drawing, because we're not plotting any of this down. We're implying all of our vanishing points. But the reason it's important to at least understand is that you can have a situation where your vanishing points are not situated correctly. And you can end up with problems. For example, I have done this far too many times where I was drawing a car and I realized that because I was working with such precise units, meaning I was dividing things into these grids that we just built with, you know, 7 units long, 2.25 units tall, and 4 units wide, because I'm already dealing with such precision, it's very easy to end up with proportions that are off if you have other aspects that are not playing well with your precision. So in other words, if you're dealing with precision at all, you can easily fall into a trap where other parts start falling apart. I'm not sure if I'm explaining this correctly. To put it simply, you can either wing it completely, be super precise with everything, or if you go somewhere in between, you gotta be real careful and you gotta be ready to see certain mistakes popping up and to kind of compensate for them as you go. So if you misplace your vanishing points, as I frequently do when drawing cars, what you might end up with is if I were to bring this back down, this is the actual reference image that we're gonna be using more directly. But if your vanishing points are not situated correctly, then you may end up with a situation where this side looks weird, because it might seem proportionally too wide, because we have more of this in our field of view. But we, in terms of the relationship between this length here and that one, pushing that so much so that this is like a mile long and this is just a quarter mile, that's going to start looking really weird. That's basically the point that I'm trying to get. If you don't position your vanishing points within a certain margin of error, things are going to start looking weird. So it's something that may happen. I personally don't have a solution for you while we're partially winging our perspective to be able to do that correctly beyond building a good sense of what kind of convergences you really want to be achieving. That's really there's a lot of advantages in what we do in terms of being really quick and not plotting everything down. It allows us to design things more quickly. It allows us to work a lot more effectively. But at the same time, we end up having to make a lot more mistakes along the way to get a good sense of what we're trying to achieve and where to best put our vanishing points and stuff like that. So just be aware of that. These mistakes do happen. I make them all the time, and I make them less now than I did before. So just keep that in mind. Anyway, that was a huge tangent about perspective. Let's get on to the actual drawing. If I can find the layer. So as I said, this is the reference image that we're going to be using for our construction. We do have a lot of different reference images. I felt like this one was the one I wanted to match, or at least, you know, use. We're not matching it 100%, as we never do. And so I will just stuff this up in the corner in case we need it. So to start with, I'm building a horizon line. Knowing where your horizon is going to really help you develop a sense for the overall construction grid that we're working with. It's a lot more precise in this manner than what we usually do, but because this is a larger object, it helps a great deal. This is another one of those areas where we're dealing with a sort of mixed precision and also winging it. Also, you'll notice here that I've drawn a vertical line. What does this vertical line represent? It represents the specific point where our box, the grid that we created, one of its corners, the one that's closest to us. So I wanted to establish that that is going to fall right here so I can build everything else off of it. This is not the specific height that we're going for. This is just a vertical line. It could have been, you know, full length, that would be fine. I'm just putting a marker there. Next, I'm establishing from the bottom of this line, or you know, anywhere along the line that I want to establish as the ground plane. I'm drawing a line going off to each individual vanishing point. This is where what I just went off on a tangent about really comes into play. Knowing where you want to put your vanishing points. If you put this one way off to be converging like this, you're going to end up with a front, which is going to be in this section, that is way too wide. And so the angle gets ridiculous, and that's not going to look correct. So instead, we've got a little bit of a, you know, it's definitely wider than 90 degrees on the, like, in the drawing, but it should work out with our vanishing point being roughly, you know, I can't really represent it in the frame of this video, but this one is obviously much closer to the side here, and then this one is a little bit further away. Next, I'm just trying to establish a little bit more to help me as I work. Meaning, this is not a grid. There's no like set unit distance here. They're not the same distance apart. They're just lines that are going to help me establish when I actually have to draw another line here, knowing that it's going to be in between these lines that are converging all towards roughly the same vanishing point. That gives me a visual cue that lets me draw those a little bit more easily. That's why a lot of artists use perspective grids. They'll set down their vanishing points, create a big grid, and as long as that grid isn't so overbearing that it like distracts them from the entire drawing, it helps them position things roughly correctly. Even if I wasn't aligning my lines to this vanishing point here, knowing that this is the line that goes off to a specific or for a specific set of lines allows me to work in relation to that. So if I wanted to create a specific box, I might be able to do it considering the relationship between this convergence and this convergence. I'm not going to draw the whole box. We don't have enough time for that. So I'm really just kind of laying down, you know, something to help support me. Now, this is where measurement and distance starts to play a role. I've drawn this little point here, and that represents roughly where I want the top of my wheel to be. And I want the bottom of my wheel to be touching the ground, which is defined by this line. And so this is going to be 1 unit tall. That's a decision that I'm making before I even draw the line that's converging off in this direction, because it's going to help me when I'm drawing that line. I know that this the line that I draw now has to pass through this point and converge towards that vanishing point. And of course, I'm doing all of this with the equivalent of a ruler. And I'm using Photoshop, so I'm using a line tool. For my ellipses that you'll see in a bit, I'm using this tool called Lazy Nozumi. It's not part of Photoshop, but it does work with most drawing software, so it's pretty great. Allows you to set a degree and, you know, orient your ellipse. resize it. It's quite handy. You can even slide it along one of the axes. So, like I said, use the tools that you need to, but draw it in a ballpoint pen. Now, like I said, I've drawn my line converging towards that vanishing point, passing through this line to establish the top of my wheel, or the plane that's going to encompass my wheel. I've drawn my ellipse. It fits snugly between them, and we can check our convergence, or not our convergence, our contact points, which are here. And it's the line that passes through them is going to converge the same way as this vertical line that we've built. It's two-point perspective, so all my vertical lines go to a vertical vanishing point that is at infinity, and therefore all these lines are parallel as I draw them. And if you, once again, if you don't know what I'm talking about, check out the How to Draw a Cylinder video and the notes that go along with it. Next, we want to do the same thing on the other side. I did forget to mention that for this other ellipse, my minor axis is going to be converging with these lines. So I already have a set minor axis that I'm going to be working with because it's going towards this vanishing point on this side. So that allows me to define the sets of criteria that I need for this ellipse to represent a specific circle in 3D space aligned to a specific minor axis and the other vanishing points. And we do the same thing, just the opposite, with the next ellipse, where its minor axis converges towards the vanishing point on this side. And we've established its contact points going straight up and down to align to the vertical vanishing point at infinity. And this top edge goes towards the left vanishing point. Now, we're simply reproducing a lot of the proportion study stuff that we did. We're looking at breaking this down into 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, and doing the same thing up here. We've hit the 2 units, so that's 1, 2, we need to add an extra quarter, and that's what we're doing here. I'm estimating that extra quarter. I could have transferred this height up once again. So I could have done something like this, ignore that other line. And then I could have, would I have to do this as well? And then I could have drawn the upper edge here. That would be 3 units, and then I could bisect it. And then do that once again to be ultra precise and to get myself a nice specific quarter. Which clearly falls well above where I put it. But at the end of the day, you're not here to learn how to do precise perspective. You're here to learn how to draw, you know, winging it. And so that's a mistake that we'll pay for, probably, because the proportions are already off, but we keep going. Next, I've just drawn the other side of this box. I do feel like at least suggesting it in a loose, you know, a light fashion, not putting too many lines on the other side, like not doing all the grid work for this stuff on the opposite side, but just putting in the framework of the other corner of this box does help me get a better understanding of how it sits in space. Since you're working with ballpoint, do take advantage of the fact that since you're drawing with a ruler as well, you can draw those lines to be faint. None of this construction needs to be super dark. The only thing is that when you're freehanding a line, I don't want you to purposely try and make a line faint, because that's just going to make you draw more carefully, not confidently enough to really get that flow and energy going, and so your line will probably wobble with hesitation. But since you're using a ruler, French curve, an ellipse guide, you can be as light as you want with these. So you can kind of control the density of line work that pops into this. Now I've just added a little bit of extra weight to the outside of this box to make it stand out more for me. And the first phase of this construction is done. We're still within the bounds of basic Drawabox construction, where we are, you know, measuring things out a little bit, you know, approximating here and there, but we're building a box, and that's what we've done. We've built a very specific box to specific measurements, 7 by 4 by roughly 2 1/4, more like 2 1/8. And, you know, we're doing okay. This is where we still, you know, it's normal stuff that we've dealt with before to an extent. Now, I'm going to drop in the wheel, the front wheel here. And in order to do so, remember, it is a cylinder. I don't just want to focus on drawing this ellipse here. So I'm drawing an entire box to kind of encompass it. With that done, I then find the minor axis for my wheel, and it's going to converge towards my vanishing, my left vanishing point. And I draw the outer ellipse of my wheel, and you can see that I've done a lot of concentric ellipses. You can use your ellipse guide for this however you want. It's just that when I use my lazy Nozumi, you know, ellipse tool, it is kind of annoying to then put the ellipse guide back in the precise place that it was previously, whereas you can probably mark down the specific degree and, you know, which ellipse from the ellipse templator guide that you were using, and you can just figure out, well, if you want to go back in and draw those extra concentric ellipses, you can do that later. I did it now because it was more convenient. And I draw the other side. Doesn't need to be a fancy thing, just needs to be a full ellipse that sits in the back plane of this box that we've created. And I'm doing the same thing on the opposite side. Get my minor axis, draw in my wheel. And here, I've just transferred that distance over a little bit so that I know where the wheel is going to sit on the opposite side. Always try and keep at least a vague understanding of what's going on the opposite side. If you focus too much on one side, you might end up in a situation where you're a little bit lopsided. You'll notice here, actually, that my angles were wrong in my box. Not so much that it's a big deal, but enough that they would not have converged properly towards the vanishing point. So keep track of that sort of thing. I caught it early, and I was able to work with fixing it. You know, not really fixing it, just keeping it from affecting the rest of my construction. So we've got two wheels in here. We know where the third is going to go. I don't really care about the fourth because that will never be drawn. Now we get into scary territory. I'm going to do my best to convey in a constructional sense how I'm building up this vehicle. And in doing so, I've generated a lot of layers, and I'm going to be stepping through each one, hopefully not taking a super long time to do so. We're already at nearly 40 minutes. But the point here is that this step is probably the closest to regular construction, stepping up gradually, that we will follow. As we move forwards, we're going to be identifying elements that are present on this vehicle. We're going to try and break them down into their simpler components and build them on top of each other, but now there's going to be bigger gaps that you need to fill in with the spatial understanding that you've developed through the rest of this course. So we've got the chassis here, and I did want to create, you know, get a sense of how it wraps around the wheel a little bit. That may not even be correct. And here, so just a general sense of how this block is actually sitting. The block is not so simple as this, obviously. So we're still keeping to a certain level of simplicity, but you've got these various planes on the front of the car. It turns a little bit. You know, this front here is probably not straight either. It's probably coming out a little bit. It's all very complicated. And so we're going to keep working that way, but we're going to start just trying to use the intuition and the spatial sense that we've developed to start establishing how these pieces fit together and come together. So here I've established this front part tilts forward. It's not parallel to if we had a straight line going towards that right vanishing point. It tilts. So I wanted to get that in now. I wanted to get in something that copied this rhythm. Oops, what did I just do? Oh. And I wanted to start breaking down the front with the headlights and the grille and all that. I wanted to start breaking them down into their own components. Still need to keep an eye on your proportion. This section is a little bit taller than the top section. And I'm working in this tilted part. And I'm leaving this area here free because I'm just focusing on subdividing this section. You can see that I've actually drawn I found a center line between this plane, and I've used it to create what is very much not like what we usually do. I'm just drawing in what a line, a sort of center line that dips into the grill a little bit and comes out. I'm already starting to construct frameworks for the curves that are all over this vehicle. And you'll find that I do that a lot more as we go. So once again, I'm trying to push these curves with contour lines, essentially. They sit on the front or on the surface of the form and they describe it. And it's not just describing it to the viewer. Those lines are helping me make sense of this complicated construction. And I'm starting to carve out these lines, this sort of, you can see it here. And at times I draw lines that I think I understand, but it turns out later on that what I thought I was seeing was not accurate. Was because there's so much going on in this reference image that there's just, it can be very distracting. And you can think that you're following one trail, but you end up following another and you make a mistake. That happens. You can still recover from this, as you will see. Perhaps one of the best reasons to follow Drawabox is that I make so many mistakes, but you can still come out on top after making those same mistakes. Here, I've just roughly implied the bump right here. I didn't want to get too much into it before I established the cab back here because they have strong relationships between each other. And being the point that kind of bridges the front of the car and the cab, I didn't want to work sort of in a linear fashion. Because if you are, let's say, this is the correct path that you're following, and you go slightly off with this bump, and then you construct the cab fully, you're gradually going to move off very far from your target if you understand the kind of abstract concepts I'm talking about. But instead, if you construct the cab more completely before you finish off this bump, let's say you get as far away as you would have from the bump, and then you try and fill in the bump in the middle, overall your divergence from your actual correct drawing is less. So you don't want to work in a way that it's kind of working your way back. It's the same idea as starting from big general shapes and working your way down. You're just applying it to, you know, all of this needs to stay fairly consistent as you move back. So instead of tackling this, then this, then this, you tackle this, then this, and then fill in the middle in between, because there's already going to be enough structure to help you construct this one within the bounds that you've created. I'm starting to get off topic. All right, so let's keep going. So I've put in the cab, and what I mentioned before about it being a fastback car is kind of relevant. You should still be studying the reference that you have. I still have it open here. There's all these different angles that you can use to understand how the parts of this car come together. Just because you're not drawing the back, like from this angle, doesn't mean that understanding how these things come together is not going to be extremely valuable to you. And so being a fastback, there is a smooth curve that comes all the way back down. And this curve may not be completely correct, but it is enough to give me a general sense of how this car fits together. Now I'm just fleshing out the opposite side of the cab, so you do have these kinds of internal things on the back that you can see, and by adding them in, I'm kind of grounding the cab as being related to the other side of the car. So I'm still thinking in 3D space. I'm not just focusing on how what I see on the page is being represented. And I'm just carrying over. It's not so much about carrying over the marks and the lines that you see present here, but rather the whole chunks of form. So I can see that this form comes out, and then it kind of dips back in. And so I'm trying to capture that here with the cut lines that are actually already present on the vehicle. So taking advantage of those cut lines that are already there in a nicely designed car can really help you ground your construction, ground your understanding of what you're making, and also convey that to the viewer. And of course, I've got the wheel wells as well. I'm just wrapping them around the construction there. I mean, the wheel. Now I'm jumping back into the front. It all comes down to the whole idea of not trying to build everything linearly, finish one part, then move on to the next. You're jumping around this vehicle to gradually define and narrow down everything else. You're still applying these concepts of construction. You're just not building every little form so specifically as we have in the past. And so I know that there's this curve here, and so I wanted to block it out, already dumping in like a solid shadow, because it just makes it easier to understand when you're working with such a heavy construction. Sometimes you do need to apply some of the organizing tactics and hierarchical tactics that we've employed elsewhere near the end. This is one of the most complicated things that you will construct, because there's just so much going on in a car. And the same deal, I've kind of extended out this bump here and down here. I've tried to keep this dip over here somewhat centered, and you can see that I've carried it all the way across, and I'm using these sorts of quarter lines to help me construct and position that feature. You shouldn't be too eager to wing it when you don't have to. You can add in these simple subdivisions to kind of say, okay, well, that's a good grounding marker for where these features might sit. And the more that you do adhere to the easy ones, the more you can keep things together. And just dropping in those bottom bites. And you'll see that I actually freehanded those, because I was getting so much into the design that you will find sometimes when you start getting into it, taking the time to pull out that ruler or that ellipse guide can be taxing, and it can require more out of you than you're willing to give it. Sometimes it's still worth it to get that really precise mark. Other times, maintaining the flow and the rhythm of what you're doing and keeping your attention on what you're drawing can in turn be more beneficial. So you need to keep that in mind, that freehanding things just because you have a ruler on hand, it's not always, drawing with a ruler just because you have it on hand is not always the best idea. Sometimes it is. Sometimes freehanding it is going to give you a better boost. Now here I'm starting to get into more of those blocking in of shadows to separate out forms and to kind of put in the last touches. You'll see that this car is actually starting to come together. I've started to think about, well, okay, I'm going to imply a little bit of tread on this wheel, but I'm really not getting into it. There's this little, I don't even know what this thing is, but it's like it's not a vent, but not sure what it is. I'm more concerned about the forms rather than their purpose here. I've got, you know, some of the internal detail here. I've got this vertical bar from the front of the door. So these are all little details that are less important to the overall construction of the car, but they're still important to kind of sell the whole illusion. You know, the grille, the mirrors. Don't forget the mirrors. They're really important, and it's just so easy to forget that they're even there. Here, I did actually want to extend the roof of the car just a little bit and to smooth it over. And I felt that it wouldn't be too distracting considering how many lines I already have at play, as long as I executed this confidently and smoothly. So for that, I might have used a French curve or something to kind of accomplish this curve more reliably. But of course, I don't have a French curve, so I had to freehand it. Although it does occur to me that I'm drawing on a Cintiq, and I could use a French curve if I wanted to. Anyway, so now here I've added a big dark cast shadow. I'm just going to get rid of the red. This obviously starts to set the car apart from all the construction lines that are present. And now the drawing is going to have those construction lines. That's just part of it. At the end of the day, we're not here again to create a pretty drawing. We're here to learn how to construct a car. We're using it as kind of a proving ground for our spatial understanding, and we're starting to break away from all the construction, but we're still relying on it very heavily. That said, as you get into the end, you have these tools that you can use to kind of bring the car out of the mess. A strong cast shadow is one of those. If I didn't have so many construction lines, I might not have filled it in. I might have left it as an outline to help ground the car, but not necessarily push or pull the lines around. But in this case, with everything going on, I felt it was important. And here I've just blocked in the inside of the car, same idea, letting these other forms like the rearview mirror and the rest of this pop out. And this is just ground detail, just to kind of make it look a little bit more, again, grounded, like there's something that it's sitting on. Don't be sloppy with this. If you've put so much time into constructing this car, you don't want to just be, you know, scribbling around on the bottom. You know, nice little puddles can help because you can show that same kind of strong black reflection lines. It can, as a compositional element, it can really help draw attention to, like, this wheel, which was in a nice focal area, and the general solidity of the car. And that's pretty much it. We're done. So we have been here for nearly an hour, and we've stepped through all of these phases, going from a proportional study, and you may want to go farther than that from what we did before. Previously, we did all of this. It may also help a great deal to, once you've pinned down these proportions, to draw out your grid in orthographic. I'm not actually measuring these out, but like laying out your grid and kind of defining that, okay, well, the hood goes out here and then the cab comes up, you know, something like that. You would generally extend the grid all the way. And figuring out where the wheels go and how everything fits together. Proportional studies like this can be very valuable to help you separate in your mind where everything is situated and how they relate to each other. You do want to cling to that as much as you can as you go through the somewhat chaotic mess that is constructing this in a three-quarter view rather than an orthographic. So I do hope that helped explain something. I know it was a long video and it was a very cluttered process, but stepping through and bridging between pure construction and really leveraging the spatial awareness that you've developed through the rest of the lessons, I hope that gave you a sense of how to approach it. And do not get discouraged if this is immensely difficult, because it is. It's so hard. And previous car demos that I've done, even last year, they've not gone super well. So even I struggle with this a great deal. So keep at it, keep working on it, and remember that the car is the final boss. You're not going to die if you lose that fight. You'll have more in the future, but testing yourself against it is a great idea. And even better, rather than starting with a sports car like this, start with the good old cars from like the 1920s. Something a little bit more like a Ford Model T, like this, where you do have those clear curves and stuff, but you can work with this. Drawing a giant box back here and then up in the front, the proportions are a lot easier to manage. And while it is still very difficult, it's kind of a bridging. It's a bridge between the kinds of constructions that we've done, like, you know, basic Bluetooth speakers and all kinds of, you know, barrels and whatever, to something as intricate with so many components. So give it a shot. There's going to be a text version of this demo in the that's linked in the description, and it will go over all the steps with text descriptions of what's going on, and, you know, you'll be able to see all the phases of construction. I hope that helped.